Good morning, church. Let's rise to our feet. We're going to give thanks to the Lord.
Thanks to the Lord, our God and King.
His love endures forever.
For he is good, he is above all things.
His love endures forever.
So sing praise. Stretched on.
His love endures forever.
For the life that's been reborn.
His love endures forever.
So sing praise.
Sing praise.
Sing praise.
Sing praise.
Forever God. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever.
From the rising.
From the rising to the setting sun.
His love endures forever.
And by the grace of God we will carry on.
Faithful God, in every circumstance, Lord, we thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness, Lord Jesus.
We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will
Go greet your neighbor. Give them a sweet embrace. Thank you.
All right, everybody, you know the routine. When the music stops, you're supposed to stop hugging and like visiting and stuff and sit down. That's how it works around here. I don't think you're buying it. Hey, well, good morning, everybody. It's great to see you. Even though the tomb has been taken away from our stage, Jesus is still alive. I hope you're still walking in the power of God's resurrection this morning. Right on. Well, listen, we just have a couple of announcements, and then we're going to receive our offering this morning. One, if you have been around Zion for a while, you might remember the Raines family, Clarence and Wilma Raines. And Clarence has gone home to be with the Lord many years ago, and now Wilma also has 2 weeks ago. And so I just wanted to let you know, if you would want to be a part of her graveside memorial service, it's at Fairhaven on Thursday. So it's this coming Thursday, right here at Fairhaven at 2:30. And this is a very special family to Zion. And one of the ways that we think of them, I think of them, every time we wheel something. Now you're saying, what? Everything around this church is on wheels, because over 20 years ago, Clarence put wheels on everything, the pulpits, the tables, everything that slides. But he was a very practical man. And the two of them were just a wonderful couple, just reflecting the glory of God. And they loved Jesus. And they're with him now, together in heaven. And that's a good thing. So anyways, if you want to celebrate her life with the rest of her family, it'll be a graveside memorial service here at Fairhaven at 2:30 on Thursday. So I think that's pretty much it for announcements. Scott, would you come and receive the offering this morning?
As the ushers are preparing to receive the offering, you know, just was mentioned in our prayer time beforehand that I guess Jan isn't doing real well this morning. And they did a blood transfusion, apparently, and it didn't help the situation. So he's struggling. So, you know, can we all go to prayer and just really reach out for him this morning as we get ready to receive the offering? Heavenly Father, God, we just come before you this morning, Lord Jesus, with an expectancy of a testimony of what you're going to do in Jan's life. Because, God, just like Pastor Danny said, you are still alive. You are not in that tomb. You rose from the dead, Lord God, and you paid the price for everything. And we ask right now that you would touch Jan where he is. God, in the name of Jesus, that you would heal him, that you would send your angels to touch him, to encourage Carla, Lord God, to lift them both up, Father, and to give him strength. In the name of Jesus, we rebuke that sickness that's in his body. And we ask that you would make him whole and cleanse him, Father. Touch him. Bring him back to us, Lord God. Full strength, Lord God, so he can stand in the center aisle and take offering once again. God, he's a son, he's a child of yours. Touch him today, we pray. And God, we ask as we receive the offering, Lord God, that you would use it for your glory. The Father, it would further your kingdom, and that those that give would give joyously, Lord God, knowing, Lord Jesus, that you will give back to them. Father, we thank you for this privilege and this opportunity to give our tithes and offerings. And God, we offer the rest of this service to you. Bless Benny as he brings us into worship. And bless the worship team, God. Bless Pastor Danny as he brings the word. Let it go forth in power. With anointing, Lord God. Let this day be a day that everything that happens glorifies you. We thank you for it, Father. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
You know, sometimes when the storms are raging against us, we just need to be still and know that He is God. And all it requires is our submission to Him. And to be quiet before Him, let Him speak to us. Let them meet us where we're at.
Soul. I rest my soul.
quietness and trust.
When the oceans,
rise and thunders roar, I will soar with you above the storm. Father, you are King of the flood. I will be still. All my strength
I will seek you. will bow down, hail you as King.
Now, and every time we sing this song, there's a line in there that is so big. It's a big line. It says, I'll give you everything. And I just want you to take a minute and think about what that looks like for you right now. The sense that I have in my heart as we're worshiping is that God is looking for us to bring who we really are to Him. And ask yourself, well, what does that look like? You know, I think that's what I'm doing, but inside of us, you know, there's us putting our best foot forward, us putting what we think God wants to see out there. But God this morning is just saying, bring everything to me. Bring your disappointments, bring your struggle, bring your trial, bring your joy, bring your victory, bring your gratitude and thanksgiving, but bring it all. And as we sing this song again, would you just take a minute and look over your life? Let's give Him everything. What a great release that we know that we have a God that we can cast every care on, that we have a God that we can just bring everything to. Take time and think about what that everything looks like for you as we're worshiping. I think God wants to meet some people in some very significant and special ways. But to the measure that we're able and willing, really willing is more the word, to the measure that we're willing to give everything, that's to the measure that He'll meet us in response. Let's just think about that for a minute before we sing it again. We declare and together, and we know that You are worthy of all praise, that You're the King that we submit to. But now, Lord, as individuals, we bring our everything to You, God, all of us to You. In worship, God, we give You it all. Let's sing this together. If you feel as though you need to come to the altar and you just want to offload some stuff, would you just do that this morning? Don't waste time. Just He is so welcoming to us just to bring and cast every care on Him. If you need to do that, then do that. If you need to stay where you're at and kneel or whatever, but let's just make this an environment where we can really meet with Him by giving everything to Him. Let's just worship Him.
Sing, I will bow down. I will bow down. I will serve you. Give you everything. greater song. A greater song to you on the earth, to sing a greater song. A greater song to you on the earth,
greater song.
Powerful things that we can do together is agree in prayer. We can all pray, but if we agree in prayer,
It's beyond words how powerful that is. It's such a multiplying effect that literally things change when we pray. I'm not saying that when you pray on your own, things don't change. I'm just saying that imagine when you pray with somebody else, what the Word of God says about unity when there's agreement on something. And I want to come in agreement this morning on like a lot of things. I want to come in agreement on things that are affecting people directly in our congregation, sicknesses. You know, we've prayed for Jan already. We're going to pray for him again. And Leslie is also in the hospital. She had another stroke, and she's experiencing pain in her head and a blood clot in her arm. And they're still trying to work things out to get her back in good health. I know that, as we said already, Jan is so dear to us, Jan and Carla. Every time the offering is taken, you know, you see him come down here. Just, and I think I told you this, but I'll tell you again if I forgot. Well, you'll hear it twice if I did. But anyways, when I was visiting him like 3 weeks ago, so weak that he couldn't open his eyes and tears just rolling down his face. And he said, "What's today?" And I said, "Today's Tuesday." And he said, "Okay, tomorrow I walk." I said, "All right." He said, "Thursday I go home." I said, "All right." He said, "Sunday I usher." That's just the resolve that he has. You know, and if somebody alone has that kind of faith, imagine what happens when we agree with the faith that he has. And so I want to pray again for Jan. I want to pray for Leslie. And in a minute, we're going to have a testimony of something that God's doing in Frank's life. But it directly relates to what he wants to do in so many of your lives too. There are many of you that are in need of work, you know, and you're in need of financial provision. And God hears your prayer and he hears your cry. He does. Just as he heard the prayer and the cry of the children of Israel when they were in an oppressive situation where they were affected by the oppression of Egypt. And they were forced to make bricks without straw. And it just was an impossible thing, and they could never get ahead. No matter how hard they worked, they had a taskmaster that was just driving them, and it was never enough. They could never get ahead. And what did they do? They cried out to God. And it took some time, not because God is cruel, but because God understands. Not because God doesn't want to act, but because God is powerful, and he's in charge of time, and he's in charge of everything. And he has a perspective that's way different than ours. But just at the right time, God spoke to Moses. Because he heard the cry of the people, he heard their prayers, he saw the injustice, and he was willing to act. God is always willing to act where there's injustice. And so there's possibly some situations going on in your workplace where there is real injustice. And God sees it and he hears. There's others of you that I believe have just a great need for provision. And you're wondering and praying and hoping and just believing God for a breakthrough there. He hears you. And you're praying on your own, and God hears those prayers, but we want to join our faith with your faith. That's what the body of Christ is all about. Galatians chapter 5 tells us to bear one another's burdens, and in doing so, we fulfill the law of Christ. What does it look like to bear each other's burdens? It means to care. It means to care that what's going on in your life affects my life. That I don't just sit back and go, "Oh, at least I'm not going through such and such," that we have some sick comparison. You know what I'm saying? That we think, "Well, it's bad for me, but at least it's not that bad." That's not what Christ is about. He's about a family. One of the prayers that we prayed today was that if anyone felt solitary this morning, if anyone felt alone, that they would be drawn into the family of God. Because that's what he says in his word. He promises that he brings a solitary into a family. So I want to tell you that whether it's a financial issue, a work injustice, a health issue, you're not alone. You're not alone. And I know there's probably other things that I haven't covered, but let's agree in prayer. The way we're going to do it is we're going to join hands together because that's a sign of unity. And you can just span the aisles. You can do whatever you need to do, but connect with somebody. I like holding hands because it's uncomfortable, right? Unity is uncomfortable. Unity breaks us out of our norms. It is so much easier to just find a spot and sit there and take it all in. It's even easier to catch it on the radio, TV, or internet, and that's no condemnation to anybody who's watching on the internet today. That's not the point. Unity is uncomfortable. Community is uncomfortable. Holding hands is a little bit odd and uncomfortable. But it's so right that we would give of ourselves, that we would bear one another's burdens, that we would go the distance, that we would make a small effort to join our hearts together in prayer. And so let's just cry out to God. Let's pray. prayers that mean something to him, and let's pray prayers of faith unified with the person that's near you. Maybe you're saying right now, well, I'm not a good prayer. Well, neither am I. You know, we're not good at this, but we have a God who loves us and who cares so much, and all he wants is communication. And so let's just communicate with God. Lift up all the burdens off your shoulders to be excellent or to be in any way profound with your prayer in your own eyes or the eyes of your neighbor. But just talk to God and just ask him to help those people that we mentioned today and help in your time of need. God, we cry out to you today. You see our hearts, Lord. Our desire is to be one today and to take you at your word when you say that if we agree on something on earth, it'll be done in heaven and it has an effect and an impact. Lord, we ask you now, God, for Jan. We know that his faith is strong, that he sees himself getting better. And Lord, we want to join with that faith, and we want to pray and believe, God, that you can do a miracle, that these years will be good years for him. Lord, that you can do something phenomenal. Lord, we know that there's some confusion about why this is even happening to his body related to his blood. And God, we pray that you would bring clarity and bring healing and bring wholeness to Jan now in the name of Jesus. Lord, may he know how much we love him. I may know this morning how much we love him, but Lord, our love pales in comparison to your love for your son. So bless him today, God, we pray. We cry out to you for that miracle. We pray for Leslie, God, as she's just right down the street in a hospital bed, believing you, God, for a miracle. We pray that same prayer along with her, that you would touch her body, Lord, that you would comfort her. And God, you would take away any sickness, any illness, any pain. And Lord, you would do a complete restoration work. We agree together for that in the name of Jesus. Lord, and I pray, God, for anyone who's going through injustice at work right now, situations that just are not right. They know they're not right. Everybody knows it's not right. Would you come, God, and would you hear the cry? And would you answer that prayer? Lord, would you move on their behalf? Would you give them your favor? I pray it in the name of Jesus. And for the ones that are having a difficult time finding work and in need of great provision, we pray that you would open the floodgates of heaven. Lord, we pray that you would shower blessings upon your children. God, we pray that you would remove whatever stopgap is there and just pour out upon them, God. Father, come, Lord, and show yourself strong. Show yourself mighty, God. Glorify yourself through a miracle in a time, Lord, when many are without work. Let the people of God be a reflection of your goodness so that they can be a blessing to other people. Not so we could stand back and say, ha ha, look, we have jobs and you don't. That wouldn't be your heart, Lord, but it would be your heart that we could be blessed to bless others. Bless your people, God. Provide for them, I pray. Bring jobs, I ask, to this congregation and to your people. Good jobs, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. If you want to continue to hold hands, you can. If you want to release that hand, that's fine, but keep the heart of unity. And as we have prayed this prayer, let's just offer up worship to God. That same song we sang, we'll sing again and just release these things to God. Let's believe that our God will act and our God can do what we can't because he's powerful and mighty. Stand in his promise this morning.
To sing a greater song. A greater song to you on the earth. To sing a
we want
Amen. You know, I want to invite you to take a seat, and I want to also invite you to stay in an atmosphere of worship because, Frank, if you would come, I asked Frank to share a testimony this morning because I know Frank pretty well. I've known him for a lot of years, but I've come to know him a lot closer in these last couple of years. And God's done a tremendous work in he and his wife's life, for sure. And you've heard some of their story and their testimony. But I remember talking with Frank on several occasions, and I hope it's okay to say, I mean, you said a lot the last time you shared with the microphone. So, but I remember the last time we were together, and I mean, talking along these lines, and even in the hospital, and you're saying, can it get any worse? Can anything else happen? You know, and so many things that it seemed were just not going the right way, and Frank and Steph serving the Lord and doing their best to honor God and offering up prayer and asking God to meet them, and things like their car just getting randomly totaled in the parking lot and no, and just a mystery about it, and you know, and kidney stones and back problems, and he's very qualified as a businessman, as a firefighter, and no job opportunities. And, you know, these things that we just look at as mysteries, huh? And you would say, could anything more happen? But their faith was strong. And how many of you know that it's okay to have emotion in the midst of all this? In fact, the whole sermon's going to be about emotion and how God meets us in the midst of it. But anyways, he's standing up here, and it's awkward now probably for you to stand while I'm talking about you. Just share what God's done in this last week, and let's give glory to God for his provision.
Well, where do I begin? I mean, I apologize. I'm a little nervous. But anyways, as Danny said, yeah, it's just been a huge struggle the past 3 years, honey, would you say? I mean, every time I share my story with friends or random people that ask me, I mean, you know, for lack of better words, they always say, like, God, I can't believe you haven't put a bullet in your head by now. With the house going down and then finding out about our son having autism and then losing my job and losing everything. So, I mean, to back up real quick, is everyone knows that I'm a fireman. I work for Orange County, and I'm part-time with Orange County. And what it is, it's I'm cheap labor for the city. And so they pay us pretty much, well, inmates make more than I do, pretty much. And I've been trying, it's true. And I've been trying for 16 years to get on full time. And I've taken every class you can possibly take under the sun. I've served for Orange County for 16 years. And I just think, like, reflecting, like, God, I've come to Danny several times, like, Why can't I get this job? You know, maybe he just doesn't want me there. You know, and Danny told me, he's like, maybe you don't want to hear this, but maybe God has you somewhere else. And I've prayed many times, and I think that, you know, especially after we've been stripped of everything, and we've poured everything way out into church and to God. And I remember my wife and I, we were talking. I had this opportunity in San Diego to interview for an engineer's position through the fire department. And we had decided that if this wasn't anything, that I was going to give up and then just move on. And so we prayed and prayed and prayed. And so Sunday was amazing, by the way, for church for us. And I remember we were just sitting here, and it was so awesome that my wife and I looked at each other after service, and we just looked at each other and said, you know what? I have a feeling that things are going to start looking up. Do you? And she looked at me, and she's like, that's so funny, because I was thinking the very same thing. And we were just like, okay. And so I happened to get an interview on Tuesday for San Diego. And again, we went into this interview, I mean, praying and praying and praying, and said, like, if it doesn't happen, then we're done. I'm going to move on. I'm going to, you know, close that 16 years of that chapter in my life and just be done with it. With the back problems and everything, it was kind of like, well, we'll just cast it out there and see if we catch any fish. So I go to my interview, and it's pretty intimidating. They have a row of chiefs there, and you're sitting in this chair, and, you know, and you're just sweating, and they just grill you, you know. I remember going praying, just go, God, give me the strength to just get through this interview. And we're sitting there, and they ask me all these questions, and I start responding, and then it turned into just a dialogue. And it was supposed to be about a 35-minute interview, and it ended up going, like, gosh, about 45 minutes. And we're sitting there, and the chief is very intimidating, by the way, and he's looking at his clipboard, and he takes his glasses off, and he's just like, I have all these questions I need to ask you. And I just want to ask you one, if you want this job. I didn't know what to say. I just sat there and I was like, God, you have such a sense of humor. You took everything from us. But you know what? He did that for a reason. He took it all away and said, I will give you your heart's desires, but first you need to come to me. And he did. Took our clothes, our home. But anyways, I tell you this story to have... You may be going through this time in your life, and you may not know why. And it may be 3 years down the road. But there's a reason why you're going through this. There really is. And you have to sit down and recognize why that you're actually, God's putting you in this terrible, terrible spot. So, you know, another fun story is, and this was Tuesday this happened to us. We're just, cloud nine. Anyways, we went to an event that my friend owns, Rockwell's Bakery, on Thursday, and Mercy Me happened to be there. I don't know if you guys who know Mercy Me as a Christian band. These guys are awesome. Very anointed band, by the way. And so I got to go and kind of be the hired help because they weren't allowed to bring friends in. And so they were doing this radio broadcast from the Fish, and Mercy Me was there. So after the event, these guys were sitting down at the table and they were having breakfast, and I walked by and I just said, hey, I'm sorry to interrupt, but I'm a huge fan of you guys. You guys are awesome. So then they started asking me questions. Long story short, they invited us to their concert, which was that night at the Long Beach Arena. And so we happened to get to go. We thought we were just going to go and sit in the crowd and just enjoy the music. And we pulled up in the back right next to their bus, and they brought backstage passes for us, and we ended up hanging out with the band for, I don't know, half an hour, 45 minutes. But the best part about it is they are truly anointed band. These guys were like, they shared a moment with the lead singer, and my wife and I were talking about how they had special needs for their child, and so it was kind of a connection, and ended up being like, you know, we will pray for you every day, you know, we'll pray for your son, and they were hoping that I was going to bring my son there so they could sing to him on stage. They wanted to bring my son on stage and sing a song to him, but yeah, amazing. But anyways, it was so God, that moment. God knew that was going to happen. God knew that we were going to get to go backstage and talk to these people and just share our story. And when they shared back, and now we kind of created a relationship with them. And I got to meet David Crowder. Love David Crowder Band. But anyways, if you get anything out of this testimony, just know that I know there's so many people in here looking for jobs. There's so many people looking for milk. And it's just, I can tell you that it's going to happen. To have faith. Pray every day that you have something going on that's tragic, and know that he knows what's going on. He puts you in that situation for a reason, and you may not know that now. God put me in the situation of being a fireman for 16 years. I worked for Orange County and tried over a dozen times to get on full time. But you know what? It wasn't that time for me. God said, in my time, not yours. And when I gave him everything, I mean everything, and came to the point where I thought, it's never going to happen. I go to this, and if anyone knows about the fire department, they take months and months and months and months to go through the process of hiring you. For him to come at me and say, I want to offer you the job right now. And I was like the fourth interview out of like 20 guys that had to come in. I wasn't the last one. And I remember filling out the paperwork just like, oh my, what's going on? He came back in here and he said, that was the best interview I've ever had. And I want to say thank you so much. It was so much fun just interviewing you. And I remember getting in my car and I was just like, oh God, that's so amazing. And I hope that, I know it's my story, but I hope that my story somehow ministers to you. I really do. So, and again, I want to say thank you to Zion. You guys are so awesome. Without you guys and the process we've been going through for the past 3 years, again, I probably would have put a bullet in my head. Because of your prayers and God and my wife, we would have never gotten where we're at today.
Amen. Thank you, Frankie. Thank you. Isn't that great? You know, I knew Frank had to tell a story this morning because it gives glory to God. And in my own life, and I want to encourage you to do the same, that I'm really trying to make things more about God than ever before. Look at what God has done, you know? That every time I walk away from a service, that he does it through people, so it's not wrong to say, wow, you know, Benny did a great job in worship because he does every week. But look at what God did in our worship. Look at what God did in the times of healing, in the times of fellowship. Look at what our God is doing. Last week, we had a whole message about it. This is our God, that we would find it so normal, such a regular part of our Christian faith that we boast about our God, that we just talk about him all the time. How freeing is that? It takes the pressure off of any one of us to perform. The only thing that we have left to do is just obey him. And he gets all the glory. And so I just want to give God glory again for what he's done. The Bible does say it. There's a response that we each play, you know. The Bible says in Hebrews that without faith, it's impossible to please God. We have to believe that he is. And that what? He's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. So press on. Continue to diligently seek God. Habakkuk the prophet, he talks about the revelation that comes, right? Can I read it to you really quick? I'm going to do it anyway, so here it comes. It says in Habakkuk chapter 2, I've been thinking about this all morning. It says in chapter 2, verse 2, it says, write down the revelation, make it plain on tablets so that a herald may run with it. For a revelation awaits an appointed time. God's got it under control. He holds the clock. It speaks of the end. It will not prove false. Though it linger, how many of you are like in the linger time right now? Go ahead, just raise your hand. You guys were in a linger, you know, and there's still other things that we're always going to linger on. But our God is faithful. Though it linger, wait for it. It will certainly come and it will not delay. Man, just receive that as a word from the Lord. And this morning, I just want to give God praise. And I don't want to do it in some hype kind of way, but can we just clap to our God and just thank him for the good things he's doing? Amen. Well, this morning I want to take you through a couple of passages of scripture, and hopefully we'll land at a story that is one of my favorite stories from scripture, and it's always the right time to talk about it after Easter Sunday. And to cut to the chase, it's the story of Jesus restoring Peter. And I love that story. When Jesus sits on the shore and cooks breakfast for the guys, and then he has a conversation with them, and we're going to get there. But if you reflect back a little bit on Easter and the story of Easter and all the emotions that surrounded it, I think that there's something that each one of us can glean if we'll put ourselves in the shoes of the disciples. We're disciples now, and we're going through things in our life, and we're waiting for certain victories, and Jesus is telling us that he's going to do certain things, and we're in a process of waiting for those things to occur. And sometimes in the midst of the waiting, things can get really difficult. And sometimes in the midst of the waiting, we experience a whole bunch of different emotions. Over and over, when Jesus talked to his disciples, he used a lot of repetition, didn't he? He told them the same thing over and over again. How many of you can relate in your own life that when God is trying to communicate to you, he's telling you it in a lot of different ways, the same types of things, whether it's trust me, or whether it's just put your faith in me, obey me, these types of things. Maybe he's been talking to you about relationships or certain things that need to be let gone. He does it in such a gracious way where he repeats it over and over. And he did that for his disciples. Why? Because they were dull. they were hard of hearing spiritually. And before we get all judgmental on the disciples, we're dull. We are hard of hearing when it comes to spiritual things. It is a product of the fallen world that we live in. And so Jesus, he is patient, but he's direct. And so I want to look at a handful of the emotions that the disciples went through from the time that they knew for sure that Jesus was going to be taken and put on a cross, and then as they processed through his resurrection. They didn't know what to do. What do you do with that? What do you do? I mean, really, come on, let's look at it in a literal way. When you walk with somebody for 3 years, you eat together every day, you watch the miracles happen, he says something's gonna happen, it happens, and then the guy raises from the dead, but he's not just a guy, he's God. And you're not really getting it the whole way, but you know what I mean? It says that they still didn't really understand what was going on. There's a lot to process through. And I think you'll find some comfort in the way that they process through it. But let's take a minute and let's just pray and ask the Holy Spirit to let whatever he wants said today to hit our hearts and what can be forgotten to be forgotten. Lord, we submit ourselves to you. God, we submit ourselves to you knowing that you are faithful, that you're in control, that you're our God. And Lord, that we go through so many things in life. And Lord, though things tarry, though things wait, you're faithful. There's a promise that awaits for an appointed time. And God, we want to walk in that. And we want our faith renewed this morning. And I pray that through these testimonies and our worship and through the reading of your word, that you would renew hope within your people, that you would renew faith this morning, that you would show just how deep and how wide and how awesome your love is. And I thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Well, if you'd turn with me to Mark chapter 14, it's the first response that these disciples show. Mark 14, 15. And a common passage of scripture as you're turning there is in Psalm 139 where Jesus, or where God through his Holy Spirit and his word says that he's familiar with all of our ways. God is familiar with all of your ways. He knows everything about you. Here's what it says in 139:1. O Lord, you've searched me and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You're familiar with all of my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely. And if that wasn't enough to know that he knows us that much and what we're going to say and do, that he also loves us, that he also still cares for us. I like to say it often because it's so true that I know myself pretty well. You know yourself pretty well. And to think that God would love us, to think that what we're capable of doing and thinking and that he would still care so much is just beyond all imagination. Well, the disciples, when they understand the story of what's going to happen and then it starts to happen, they freak out a little bit. And we freak out when things go wrong. We do. We lose it a little. And some of the common human emotions when pressure comes to us and when crisis comes, they call it flight, fright, and fear, right? Did I get that right? Fight. Fear and flight. Well, yeah. Anyways, you get what I'm saying. And that's exactly what these guys did. We read about it in Mark 14. Here they were so close to Jesus. They were so close to him. And then it says this one passage in Mark 14, 50, which is such a sad passage, but it's so true. It says, all of them deserted him and fled. This is in the garden when the soldiers come. Every single one of his disciples bolted. Every single one deserted. Did I get in the wrong verse there? Mark 14, verse 50. Then everyone deserted him and fled. And a young man was wearing nothing but a linen garment, and he followed Jesus. And when they seized him, he fled naked, leaving his garment behind. I always just like to add that because that's funny. I mean, come on. Just face it. That's how desperate they were. They were afraid. They were afraid because they came to arrest Jesus, and these guys were associated with Jesus. And he was so afraid that he took off running, and he didn't care that he left it all behind. He was taking off. He wasn't going to end up on a cross just like Jesus. He was going for it, whatever this disciple was. We've said this before. We know the word of God is true when things like that are written in it. If it was a fable, if it was a story, they wouldn't leave parts like that in it. It's called the criterion of embarrassment, that when embarrassing things are left, when real people did dumb things and we get to read about it, we know that we're talking about people just like you and I. He left afraid and he ran. The next verse, let's flip quickly to John 20, verse 18. Man, time sure flies when you're having fun on a Sunday morning. John 20, 18. I'll just read it. It says, Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news. I've seen the Lord, she told them, She told them the things that he had said to her. And on the evening of that first day, and this is what it says, when the disciples were together, all full of faith and boldness. No, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came among them and said, peace be with you. They were afraid. They ran. They isolated themselves. I know that we're not the disciples, but how many of you can relate when crisis comes? Some of the things we do is we get afraid. We go and hide. We lock the door. We just want to be away from everything, and Jesus meets them. The next thing, I'm just going to go through these pretty quick. Mark 16, 9 is the verse. They not only struggle with flight and isolation, but they also struggle with unbelief. Unbelief is a difficult thing because it is the absolute enemy of our faith. And for them, it plagued them. And Jesus dealt harshly with it in love, but he still directly said, this word in Mark 16, verse 9. Let me read it. It says, Jesus rose early on the first day of the week, and he appeared to Mary Magdalene, out of whom he had driven seven demons. There's a story there. In verse 10, she went and told those who had been with him and who were mourning and weeping. And then they heard Jesus was alive and that she had seen him, and they did not believe it. And afterward, Jesus appeared in a different form to two of them, and they were walking in the country. And these returned and reported it to the rest, but they did not believe them either. Now listen to what it says in verse 14. Later, Jesus appeared to the 11 as they were eating, and he rebuked them for their lack of faith and their stubborn refusal to believe those who had seen him and after had risen. You don't have to raise your hand on this, but when I read that and I was kind of meditating on that scripture, when I read that about stubborn refusal to believe, that is an absolute choice to not believe something, right? How many of you in your hearts can know that there are certain things that just grate you the wrong way, that you stubbornly refuse to believe it? That could not be true. That's just what faith is about. It's sometimes we have to believe in things that absolutely don't seem true at all. And then the distraction comes. And this is where I want to end up. This is the story where Peter tries to go and get distracted. And so turn with me now finally to John chapter 21. And this is where we're going to end up, John 21. I'm going to read you this story. And I really want to ask you to sit back and listen to it and hear it in your heart. But this is a story that after Peter had failed so miserably, Jesus so graciously brings him back into a place of restoration. He's a redeemer. We talked about that on Easter, that not only does he pay the ransom for our sin, but just like in Frank's story, he repays the years that were robbed and stolen away. Some of you are sitting here this morning in the midst of that time where you just feel like you've been ripped off, and you have, and it's sad. And I don't say that in a patronizing kind of way. It breaks my heart. It grieves me. There are things in my own life, and all of us, we all struggle in certain ways. But when we begin to fix our gaze on a redeeming God, we see the character and the nature of our God and how gracious he is. It brings a whole new level of faith that starts to rise up in us. And this story in John 21 is the epitome of God's redemptive power. So here we go. You can sit back and just listen, or you can read along with me. But John 21, verse 1, it says, afterward, Jesus appeared to his disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. And it happened this way, that Simon Peter and Thomas, called Didymus, and Nathanael from Cana of Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. Now verse 3 says this, I'm going out to fish, Simon Peter told them. And they said, we'll go with you. And so they went out and they got into the boat, and that night they caught nothing. And early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. And he called out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? No, they answered. In verse 6, he said, throw your net on the right side of the boat and you'll find some. And then they did, because they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Verse 7, the disciple whom Jesus loved said, Peter, it is the Lord. And Simon Peter heard him say, it is the Lord. And he wrapped his outer garment around him, for he had taken it off. And he jumped in the water. I got to just pause there for a minute and tell you. We were at Palm Desert. We got a chance to get away as a family for the last week, for just a couple days. And you know, they have a great pool there. And my little boy, he says, I'm just like Peter. And he kept trying over and over again to step off the step and walk in the water. He'd go back down. He would do it over and over again. It was the cutest thing ever. I was hoping that he would connect at one point and just be walk. Wouldn't that be cool? Just like walk across the faith of a child. It was funny. The other thing he was doing, I was telling Millie, it was so cute, because he's learning the 23rd Psalm, right? Which is good that you teach your kids scripture. They can retain it, man. And don't underestimate what your kids can retain. They're sponges. So he's pushing off, and he's a little afraid because I'm trying to teach him how to swim. He's a little sketched about going. And so he's pushing off going, the Lord is my shepherd. I just thought that was cute. I didn't even tell him to do it. I was so proud of him. So anyways, back to the story. In Verse 8, the other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards. And when they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals with fish on it and some bread. In verse 10, Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish that you have. And Simon Peter climbed aboard the boat and he dragged the net to shore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many in the net, the net was not torn. And Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. And none of the disciples dared to ask him, who are you? For they knew it was the Lord. And Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them. And
and did the same with the fish. And then was the third time that Jesus appeared to them and the disciples after he was raised from the dead. And verse 15 says, when they finished eating, Jesus said to Simon, Simon Peter, son of John, do you love me more than these? And Jesus said, yes, you know that I love you. And Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you truly love me? And he answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And he said, take care of my sheep. And the third time he said to Simon, son of John, do you love me? And Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? And he said, Lord, you know all things and you know that I love you. And Jesus said, feed my sheep. What a story. What a story. And what a picture of who Jesus is. And if you were on the men that were on a men's retreat, man, we got such good insight on this story from our speaker, Larry Powers. He brought out things that I had never seen before. And some of those things I want to share this morning. But there are so many observations of what's happening while Jesus is there on this on the shore. You know, the very first thing that grips my or gets my attention is when Peter makes the statement, I'm going out to fish, right? I'm going to go fishing. Well, what do you do when you don't know what to do? What do you do when everything seems to be falling apart around you? You know, for Peter, it was, I'm going to go back to the thing that I used to know how to do really good. And it had been some time since he had fished. And guess what happened? He was no longer good at it. He went to throw the net out, and they did this thing all night, and they couldn't catch any fish. I've heard people say it in prayer and in other times when we feel God's presence moving among us. We say, Lord, ruin us. Just wreck us, God, right? What are we saying? Do we want our life to be a mess? No. What we're saying is, Lord, wreck us for the ordinary things. Fishing was ordinary to Peter. That was what he was raised to do. He was a fisherman, right? He's a rough guy, and he knew how to fish. But here in the midst of his own crisis where he flees in fear and goes back to just something that would make him feel good. I want to do something I'm good at. And he goes back to fishing, and he isn't good at it anymore. What a thing, right? And this is something of application for each one of us, that as we move on and as we press on with God, some of us in this room have walked with God for 50 years. Some of us have walked with God for longer. I haven't. I'm not even 50 years old yet when I say us. But some of us have walked with him for a long time. Some of us are beginning to our walk with God. But one thing that we can always count on is that obedience requires change. Obedience requires change. You can't have obedience and not change. Something has to change. And sometimes we don't obey God and we don't walk in the fullness of obedience because we're afraid of the change part. Something is different. Am I speaking English? Is this, do you agree with me on that? Amen. Right on. Thank you, Elena. You. No, it's true. If we want to obey him, something is going to change. And it's going to feel weird in the beginning, but it's going to have a greater impact in the end. That thing that changes needs to change anyhow. And so for Peter, he couldn't go back to what was familiar, what was normal. There's nothing wrong with being a fisherman, but that just wasn't his call. God had changed who he was from a fisherman, which we'll find out. He's a shepherd now. He's not a fisherman anymore. The verse that always comes to my mind is Proverbs 3, when it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. My own understanding will always lead me to my default, what I think I'm good at. But when I trust in the Lord with all my heart, he always points me to a challenge. And the challenge is something that I can only attain with him strengthening me to do it, with his grace empowering me to do it. That's what obedience is all about. The next verse, let's read it again in verse 4. It says, early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize it was Jesus. He called out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? And they answered, no. We all know this, and I think I've said it before in teaching this passage, but if you're fishing and you're not catching any fish, and somebody asks you if you caught any fish, you're not happy, right? I mean, come on. See, people who fish know what I'm talking about. Especially the fishermen on the pier, because they have those buckets there, right? And my kids love to walk on the pier and check in the buckets and see if there's any fish there. And then when a kid does it, it's even worse, you know? You catch anything? No. Beat it. Or you're looking in the bucket, there's only bait in there, you know? It's like, oh, your fish is all cut up and nasty. It's my bait, you know? The opposite is true, though. When there's like a nice-sized fish, and they're like, oh, yeah, son, you wanna touch it? Come here, look at it. You want to take a picture with it? You know, you're so proud of what our accomplishments are as fishermen, right? So for these guys, I'm not sure that this is what was happening, but it sure applies to our own life that, man, when pride sets in, when we think we're good at something, and then someone just sort of asks a question that states the obvious. No, we don't have any fish in there. And then Jesus says, hey, put the net on the other side of the boat. You know, I'm not a net fisherman, I like to fish, but I'd sure like to think that that there isn't much of a difference between boats that are maybe this big or that big, you know, from going from one side to the other. I don't know. But for them, they did it. Why did they do it? Because I think so much more was happening in this story than just what we read about. He was taking them on a walk down memory lane. Do you remember what happened 3 years ago with these guys when he's talking to them about their fishing? You can read about it in Luke. In Luke, they were out fishing and they weren't catching anything either. And what does Jesus say to them? 3 years prior, hey, you guys, put the net in the deep water. And they're, okay, we're not catching anything. Anyways, they put the net in the deep water. What happens? They start pulling in so much fish that their nets tear. They pull in so much that they start calling their buddies to throw the fish in their boats and their boats start to sink. Do you remember that? It's in there. It's in Luke. You can read about it when he was calling the disciples. And I wonder if something started to connect. They can't see his face. They don't know who he is. But they remember another time that this same kind of thing happened. And so they put the net on the other side. Fish are in it. They bring it in. And then one of the disciples says, hey, that's the Lord. That's the Lord. That's what kind of gives me the indication that they know, hey, only he could do that. Only he is bold enough. Only he can make fish get in our net when it shouldn't make sense for them to be in our net. And something starts to stir in them. And then the story goes on. In verse 6, he says, throw your net to the right side and you'll find some. And they do it and they haul it in. And the number of fish is so great. And then the disciple whom Jesus loves said to Peter, it's the Lord. And then on in verse 8, it says, as Simon Peter heard him say, it's the Lord, he wrapped the outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and he jumped in the water. And the other disciples followed the boat with a net full of fish, and they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards. And when they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals with fish on it and some bread. And Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish that you've just caught. Now, I just read that, and I've read it twice now. But in that little bit of scripture, so much more is being said than what I just read to you. And you're saying, what? Well, remember the story now. He's taking them on a walk down memory lane. There he is, Peter. He jumps right out of the boat. It was just such a Peter thing to do. It wasn't the first time that he jumped out in the middle of the water. And he makes his way over to Jesus. And what we learned on our men's retreat, which was such an interesting observation that only a real scholar like our teacher there could have found. But there's a specific word in the Greek language. Now, when you study the Bible and you dig into the Bible and you find something in the Greek language, it doesn't mean you get a new meaning of scripture. It just means you get greater coloring of it, right? And you get a deep message that's there. So you can read it at face value, but you find something like this and it begins to pop off the page. There's a Greek word for a fire of coals. A specific type of fire. The Greek language is very specific. It can talk about, you know, seven different kinds of love, not just one. But in the same way, there are different kinds of fire that are descriptive of this fire. It is a fire of coals. And so Jesus is out there. He's building a fire of coals. This particular word is mentioned two times in Scripture, once here and then once in John chapter 18, a fire of coals. What happened in John chapter 18? Does anybody know offhand? Well, I'll tell you. In John chapter 18, Peter stood around a fire of coals, a very specific kind of fire. And around that fire of coals, he warmed himself with some other people. And in his moment of total weakness and fear and anxiety, when crisis came to him, he made the biggest mistake of his life. What did he do? He denied Jesus. He said, I don't know him. He called down curses upon himself and said, hey, if I'm not telling the truth, then let me be cursed. I don't know the man. Three times. Jesus had told him he was going to do this, and he said, no way. Jesus, there is no way I'd go to the death for you and with you. These other clowns that call themselves disciples, they might do it, but not me, right? But there he was, out of fire of coals, warming himself, and he makes that mistake. And later you find and you read in Scripture that after making the mistake, he goes away and he weeps bitterly. You don't have to take a show of hands on this one either, but I just want you for a moment to think about mistakes that you've made in your life. Not just mistakes, but failures. Every single one of us in this room has made them. Some society might look at it and go, whoo, you blew it big. Others, they go, oh, that's not a big deal. But to us as individuals, we know that all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory, that we have all failed on one level or the other. And when we read about Peter's failure of denying Christ, we think, man, you really blew it, pal. But see, he went away and he wept bitterly. And there's something to the repentance of just knowing that we failed so desperately. And sometimes we just want to stay there in that weeping and in that sorrow of just knowing we blew it, you know, and we just feel like we're dirt. And we read like in Scripture, I'm a worm of a man. I'm a horrible person. Well, that's where Peter was at. And so now he finds himself with Jesus again, walking down memory lane with his buddies, his brothers, his disciples. and he's making breakfast for them around a fire of coals. It's a walk down memory lane. If you're looking for a title for the thing, this is a very special breakfast, is what I called it. The second thing is there's fish already on the fire, on the grill. I read that like 15 times. What does that mean? There's fish already on the grill. They just caught 153 fish. But Jesus, so like Jesus. I mean, couldn't you just picture him? Just all servant-hearted and so loving and so direct and just so perfect. Fire's already made and there's fish already there. He says, come on, guys, let's have breakfast. Could it be possible that they would think, when was there another time when there was just a couple of fish and then he brought a bunch of other fish? More than one time, Jesus had done this fish miracle, right, where he multiplied the fish and the loaves, and there was bread and there was fish here at this thing. And so they come and they see it already there, and then there's 153. He says, hey, you guys, bring your fish too. Do you remember in that other miracle he did the same thing? He multiplies the fish and he gives them the baskets and say, you go and you feed the people. There's no mistakes, as we learn on our men's retreat. There's no mistakes. There's no accidents in Scripture. Everything has a meaning. And here they are. They're walking again down memory lane. And now this isn't just for Peter. Peter's thing was about the fire of coals. Now for the rest of the guys in the boat, they're also remembering who they were. They're not good fishermen either. They're participants in the kingdom of God. They're disciples of Jesus. They're guys who've seen miracles. And so then he goes on, and then the third thing, let me read in verse 11. Simon Peter climbed aboard and dragged the net to the shore, and such a large number of fish, 153, but even with so many in the net, it wasn't torn, which is different than the time before. There were so many fish, but the net was torn, but I don't have time to talk about that. In verse 12, Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. And none of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? For they knew it was the Lord. And Jesus came and took bread and gave it to them, and with the same fish. And this was now the third time Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was dead. Do you remember another time in Scripture that was really close to this whole event where Jesus took bread and he gave it to them? Same stuff. He takes bread and he gives it to them and he breaks it and says, this is my body that's broken for you. It wasn't long before that they had all sat together and Jesus washed their feet, and Peter wanted to get washed when he found out what it meant, wash my whole body. Jesus washes their feet and he serves them and he breaks bread and they have a meal of bread together. It's the Passover. And that was the very time that they had been told by Jesus that one was going to deny them and one was going to give them up or absolutely, you know, just reject him completely. It's all there. The stage is completely set. And then the questions begin to happen because God is so good that he... He doesn't leave us in our failure. He doesn't leave us in our desolation. It's been kind of a theme that if you're going through desolation, you're in a good place because that's when restoration can happen. Until everything is broken and stolen away from you or taken away from you or given up, until your gaze becomes him and him alone, then the things become built back in your life. Here's what happens. You know this passage well. He says this question that I find really interesting, and I don't know that I ever saw it like this until this time. But the verse 15, it says, when they had finished eating, and I wonder what that meal was like, you know. When they finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you truly love me more than these? More than these. He didn't say, Peter, do you love me? He said, Simon Peter, do you truly love me more than these? Who are these? His buddies that were there, the same guys that he had thrown under the bus before and said, they'll deny you, but I won't. And see, Jesus paints the picture. He takes them on a 3-year walk down memory lane. They're there. They're all together in the same place. Do you love me more than these? He says, yeah, Jesus, I love you more than these. He goes on to the next question. Yes, I love you. And then he says, feed my lambs. In verse 16, Simon, son of John, do you truly love me? And he answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And Jesus said, take care of my sheep. And then the third time he said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? And what does it say? Peter was hurt because he asked him a third time, do you love me? And he said, Lord, you know all things and you know that I love you. Feed my sheep. And we all know why Peter was hurt this third time. It was like, have you ever been so set up and something, a progression of things is happening, and then you get the aha moment and it just all kind of clicks? I pray that happens for us often in church settings where we're gathered like this, that a revelation will come, that that's what it means. Well, that's what was happening to Peter. Jesus masterfully just sets him up, makes everything a teachable moment. And it gets to this point where finally he asks him the third time. And what could have only made it any greater, not that you could add anything to Scripture, but if there was a cock-a-doodle-doo that went on in the background, it would have been like, oh, yeah, duh, this is what it is. And he says, oh, yeah. Three times around a coal fire, Peter denies Christ. And now three times with Jesus, he gets the opportunity to say to him, affirms his love, yes, I love you, yes, I love you. Oh, this hurts. This hurts, but yes, Jesus, I love you. And what we learned on the men's retreat, what I would say to you today, is that failure with Jesus is never final. That was the quote that Larry gave us. Failure is never final with Jesus. You know what the devil would want you to believe? Failure's final. You blew it so bad that there's no turning back. I mean, come on, guys. Look at Peter here. Literally denies Christ. Failure is never final with Jesus. You see, this wasn't just Peter's restoration, but this was the disciples' restoration. He brought them all together. He served them. He loved them. He talked to them. He reminded them who they were. He reminded them of their journey. He reminded them of the miracles, and he did it all through breakfast with fish. Isn't that awesome? It's awesome to me. I don't know. Not eating fish for breakfast, but the whole idea of what he was doing. Why? Because if there's any lesson I could say that I'm learning in my life right now is that I can't do this thing alone, my faith meaning. Peter couldn't do this thing alone. When he tried to do it alone, he failed miserably. He needed his brothers. He needed his disciples because something was going to happen in a few days. Jesus, his work on earth was done, but his mission was just getting started where the Holy Spirit was going to come and empower people to do the work of God. You know, I can't really say, I don't know how this hits all of you, but if you'll take anything away, take a few things away this morning. Take away the fact that God's not done with you, that he is all about processes, and processes take time. This particular process took a little bit of time. It was a buildup. He ramped it up. He's doing so much in one setting, in one situation. He's doing a lot of things through the difficulty that you're walking through the pain that you're walking through. He's doing a lot. But if you're open to him, if you're open to hear what he's trying to say, man, he can do that aha moment for you, just like he did for Peter, and restore you so wonderfully. There's nothing that you could have done, that you could do, that your failure is not final. And so don't believe that lie. Don't believe it over your life, and don't believe it over the lives of those that you love so much. His timing is perfect. I want to invite our worship team to come back because I need to close the service. But as I close it, I want to leave you with some application. Because you can only wonder what it would have been like for the world, or what it would have been like for Peter if he would have stayed in his desolation. If he would have just sort of hung out and wallowed in the sorrow of what he had done. I'm not saying that there aren't seasons where we realize what we've done and what we've failed in is so miserable that we just can't seem to recover for a little bit of time. It's part of the process. But there comes a point where we've got to get out of that and get into the restoration that God longs to give us. I just put here in a couple of notes that if we continue wallowing in the sadness of our failure, we can't walk in our calling. We sideline ourselves so much quicker and so much longer than God does. That's got to mean something to somebody. Because for us, we put the punishment on ourselves so much greater than God does. Do you have to repent? Absolutely. Do you have to be sorrowful for what you've done? Yes. But what was the cross all about? What was the resurrection all about? Wasn't it about redemption and forgiveness of sin so that you could be made brand new? And doesn't it say in Scripture that as far as the east is from the west, that's how far he removes our transgressions from us, as long as we take 6 years of a time out and don't do anything for God in those years because we want to beat ourselves for what we've done? No, it's not what it says. He removes that transgression from us so that he can bring us back into restoration. And if we miss that, we miss the filling and the indwelling of the Spirit of God to let us do what he wants us to do. If we're fearful and confused about the future, we'll miss out on the fact that he is an ever-present help and empowerment right now. If we stay isolated or distracted with attempts of doing what we think that we're good at, if we go back to fishing when we're not fishermen anymore, we miss completely what God wants to do in us. One last thought, and then we're going to just leave it to the Lord. Peter obviously had a pride problem. Peter's pride problem is what got him in trouble. Peter's pride problem is what made him believe that he was a little bit better than the other disciples, that he couldn't do
you know, that he was going to be the one that would fight to the end. He was the guy, remember, that pulled his sword out right away. He was ready to fight everybody, and he would do it all by himself. Doesn't say anyone else pulled out their sword. In this time when Jesus was restoring him, I got to believe that he learned something about his own character, that he needed his brothers, that he needed Jesus. And what I believe is that later on, he writes an epistle or a letter to the church. And it means so much coming from Peter. If any of the other guys had read it, it would have still been equally as true for us today. But it just means something coming from Peter, knowing who he is and how bad he had blown it. You know this scripture because I quote it all the time. It says this. I'll give you the full picture. 1 Peter 5:5. Young men, in the same way, be submissive to all those who are older. Remember who's saying this now? It's Peter. All of you, clothe yourself with humility toward one another, because God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, that he may lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on him, because he cares for you. Be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that your brothers throughout the world are undergoing the same kinds of suffering. It means something no matter what, but it means something hugely significant in light of knowing that Peter was the one who wrote it. Let's just stand to our feet this morning. And let's allow the restoration process, the redemptive process happen in our life. Maybe you're in the middle of it. Maybe you're just starting it. Maybe you're coming on the tail end of it. Who knows? But let's just worship Jesus, knowing that he never allows our failures to be final. He doesn't sideline us. We sideline ourselves. God, we welcome forgiveness of sin here, Lord. We welcome the process of repentance. And I pray that if there be anyone that's here, that is on the sideline or on the outskirts because of the foolish mistake that they made, Lord, I pray they would take comfort in Peter's story. They would take comfort in the disciples' story. That these are men who took off running, who locked the door, who hid out, who tried to go do another kind of career. And you came and you met them and you reminded them who they were. You reminded them what they were trained to do. And then you released them into this mission to go into all the world and preach the gospel. But they would never be able to do it unless they let themselves get restored. Thank you for the process. Thank you for your great care. Thank you, Lord, for how methodical you are, how teachable. You make everything a teachable moment, just as you did for them. Now teach us this morning, we pray, what it means to be restored. Teach us this morning what it means to be empowered by your Holy Spirit, to be healed, and to be humble. And we thank you for it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Let's worship him one last song. for your character and your nature, that Jesus, you're so loving and that you're so kind, you're so perfect, you're so clear, and that you do lead us through processes. Some processes take a month, some take 16 years, some take 20 years, some take 2 years. But God, would you give us that ability to just let you be in control of time, to let you be in control of our lives? And regardless of our situation, our circumstance, our failure, whatever it might be, that we would keep our eyes fixed on you, that we would serve you, and that we would thank you, that we would walk with you despite whatever's going on in our life. I pray encouragement, Lord, over each one today, that they might find a connection with some of these disciples, that they would realize just how much alike that we can be, that we have the same emotions, the same fears, the same concerns, and that we serve the same Jesus. The same one who would come and answer our fear and calm us and remind us who we are, remind us what we're trained to do, remind us of the empowerment and the filling of the Spirit of God that enables us to do great things for you. Pour out upon each one, I pray today. Pour healing upon them, I pray. And bring provision to them, God. Bless them, I ask, in the name of Jesus. And I thank you for it. Amen. Amen. God bless you.